Did you know that one of our core values at Life Connection Church is that every believer is equipped to minister gospel of the kingdom?
Amen.
Isn't that a cool value?
Yeah.
So I'm coming today not as someone who is, I think she has it all together, but I'm just coming because God is doing an equipping in me as part of this church body to equip you. So I'm not actually going to bring you anything new today. This is not new news I'm going to be preaching. I'm actually going to be preaching the good news today, the gospel. Yeah. All right, so are you ready for it?
Yeah.
All right, so let's pray first. God, we believe that we read the Bible not just to gain knowledge, but to transform our hearts and lives through the revelation of the Holy Spirit. God, I'm just asking that you reveal yourself to us today and use my words to encourage and to equip our body. We thank you, God, you are so good to us. Amen.
Yeah.
All right, so I have recently begun to study the concept of kingdom. We use that word a lot, right?
Yeah.
We just use it in the Lord's Prayer. Sorry, I must be a little bit nervous because my throat is dry and I've just barely started. We use it, we actually use it a lot in our church family, but actually in the church as a whole, right? We say we are bringing the kingdom, we live by kingdom principles, we invite others into the kingdom. And once you start looking for the word kingdom in the Word of God, it is everywhere. The theme of kingdom runs all the way from Genesis all the way to Revelation. And if you're tracking kingdom, once you've seen it, you can't unsee it. It's everywhere.
Yeah.
So I started to wonder about this whole thing of kingdom, and I was having a conversation with my Aunt Bernita. So shout out to my Auntie Bern in Blind Bay. And she mentioned a book that she had come across by a guy named Patrick Schreiner. And it's called The Kingdom of God and the Glory of the Cross. It's just a short little book. And so I've been reading that book. And so what I'm reading to you is not anything new, nothing fabulous that I've come up with, but just what I've been studying. And I just want to share some of the ideas of kingdom with you. And maybe at the same time, I think anytime I stand up here, you can just know that my goal is always to direct you back to the Word of God for yourself. So just so you know, that's my goal. I want you to become so intimate with the Word of God that it becomes a living, breathing part of who you are, because that's the intention of our living word. So my goal as an up-and-coming speaker of this church body is to encourage you to become a student of his word.
Amen.
Okay? So every time you see me, I'm going to talk about the word of God with you. It's going to come up in conversation because this, I'm so determined to know my king and to know his word.
Yes.
And to live by his principles. Yeah. So what does kingdom mean? We need clear understanding, because we're using that word all the time, right? So when you think about a kingdom, think about earthly kingdoms. Kingdom needs a king. Make sense?
Yeah. Yep.
Can't be a king if you don't have people to rule over.
Yep.
And kings and people need to be someplace, right? So I've come across this definition a couple of different times in some studies I'm also doing online and some free courses through biblicaltraining.org, which if you've never checked out, it's really cool. But I've heard this definition a couple of times. I'm going to just read it for you so I get it right. The kingdom is the king's power over the king's people in the king's place. Right? Or, this is another way to put it, God's kingdom involves God's people, God in God's place, under God's rule or his power. Okay? So for me, I love alliteration. I love the whole piece. We got the people, we got the power, we got the place, right? So that's what we're going to talk about today. So when you think back to the Old Testament, the Jewish people were certainly looking for a king, right? All throughout history, they've been waiting for the arrival of this king who would come in power, who would free his people, and set up his rule in a land, in their place, right? So they knew the Law and the Prophets, they knew the promised Messiah was coming, and they were waiting for this powerful king, not just a king, the king of all kings. So Jesus arrives, and he did not look at all like they were expecting. He did not restore the land they expected him to restore. He didn't free the people that he expected them to free.
Yeah.
And he didn't even wield the kind of power that they expected him to wield, right? So he was expected. But when he came, he just wasn't what they expected. So this actually caused a bit of a problem because he actually turned the concept of kingdom completely on its head. this upside-down kingdom that we are living in today. And it so totally changed the concept of kingdom that it actually caused division, caused disagreement, caused disillusionment, and it caused disbelief. All the disses. This is not good news. Okay, that's a bad joke, bad joke. But I'm going to tell you the good news, all right? And ultimately, this so-called all-powerful king would actually be murdered for what he brought to the earth. So I know we're all really familiar with the story of the Samaritan woman at the well. If you're not familiar with it, you can find it in John chapter 4. I'm going to give you the Coles Notes version. Okay. So Jesus actually ends up at a well. It's actually Jacob's well that was dug by Jacob. And a Samaritan woman has come to draw water from the well in the middle of the day. And it's this into the setting that Jesus decides to come and initiate a conversation with this woman. But she's not just a woman, she's a Samaritan. So she's already an outcast. She's already not treated with any value in her, because she's by virtue of being a woman and a Samaritan. She's also an outcast amongst her own people because she's actually living in sin. Right? So she's had multiple relationships that have all broken down, and she's currently living with someone that is not under the covenant of marriage. And so she's actually an outcast, which is why she's at the well in the first place, and why Jesus knows she's going to be there by herself in the middle of the day, and why he decides to go there. This was not just a random meeting. This was Christ setting something into motion, because when Christ came to earth, he brought the kingdom, and he was going to bring the kingdom to her that day. So he went and had a conversation with this woman, and he offers her living water. All right. And she seems interested, she's curious, but then she seems to change the topic. And she starts asking him, because maybe she's skeptical about this whole living water thing, and she asks him, okay, what about this whole worship thing? Jews say we need to worship in Jerusalem, we say we worship on this other mountain, what's up with that? And I guess she's talking about spiritual things with this rabbi, right? But he actually just surprises her because he says to her, neither of those places is actually the place. So this is what it says in the word. I think I'm picking this up in verse 23-ish. Yet a time is coming and has now come. I want you to think about that. A time is coming and has now come. When the true worshipers will worship the Father in the Spirit and in truth, for they are the kind of worshipers the Father seeks. And the woman said to him, I know that the Messiah is coming. She knew. She also knew the promises. Yeah. And when he comes, he will explain everything to us. And then Jesus declared, I, the one speaking, I am he.
Yeah.
Wow. So she has this knowledge that he's going to come speak to them. This speak to us. Here's the king. He's come to speak to her. And little does she know, she's the first person he's openly said that so clearly. First person that's recorded in the Bible, that he is the one that they've been waiting for. So here's this woman, outsider, outcast. She's got these failed relationships. She's living in sin, and Jesus comes to her. I get a little bit emotional because I think of my own life. And Jesus has come to me. Anyways, what's her response? She believes him automatically, and she rushes out with absolute, here's this woman who's been hiding from other women in the community. She rushes out, and she tells everybody, that here's this guy who told me everything I ever did. She's not even ashamed anymore. She's like, yeah, he told me about this, and this, and this, and this. And she's like broadcasting her sin, because something has transformed in her heart, right? And that's the beauty of God's kingdom. He comes, he brings his kingdom, and it transforms us right away. But have you ever thought about what happened after Jesus left that day? So she was changed. Her heart was changed. The way she thought was changed. Her concept of herself was changed. She's been given a new identity. She starts to believe, maybe I have a purpose. Maybe there's hope for me. And I don't doubt that God used her. In fact, it says just a few verses later that salvation came to lots of Samaritans in that area. And I kind of wonder, now the Bible doesn't say this, but I kind of have to wonder, when the disciples in Acts then go back to Samaria, how many of the they run into who had known that woman, who'd heard the message already, and they just had to come and reinforce what they'd experienced with Christ. So I'm no doubt God used her, right?
Yeah.
But had her situation changed? Had her circumstances changed? No. She still had broken relationships that had to be healed. She still had to face challenges, sickness, age, eventual death, right? She still had all these things to face, but she had changed.
Yes.
So there's this real tension that exists in the kingdom that came when Jesus came to earth and inaugurated the kingdom. But we are living in this in-between kind of stage where the kingdom has come, but it hasn't been fully realized yet. It's not fully completed. And there's tension in that, but there's also hope and beauty in that as well. So I'm hoping to show that to you today. So we're just going to take a little walk through, as seed, that whole thing of us being seed, we're going to take a walk through the Gospels, and because the Gospels actually set the stage for, each of the Gospels actually has a little bit of a focus on one particular aspect, or they emphasize, maybe is that the way to say, of the kingdom and of the kingship of Jesus. And then Acts, which is what we're talking about, the New Testament church, actually extends that idea of how do we actually advance the kingdom.
Yep.
So I'm going to take you back a little bit. We're going to explain the kingdom a little bit more. All right, so let's start. I always had 11 pages of notes whenever I speak. I'm trying to get it down to 7, which is the number of perfection. So I'm moving on to my next page. So let's start in Matthew. And I'm hoping to show you that Matthew's focus is on revealing Jesus as the long-awaited king, the seed of David, who came to reorder the earth, the place, and make it more like the heavenly realms.
Yes.
Okay? So if you study Matthew, which I hope you will, take your summer months to study the book of Matthew. It's very, very theological and actually very in-depth and a hard one to study, but you'll get so much out of it. You'll start to see that Matthew's focus, was on showing the king's power in a particular place. That whole thing of reordering earth to become more like heaven. So Jesus, the heavenly king, came down in physical form to the earth, and he united earth and heaven through his very presence here. And Matthew deals a lot with this whole idea of the upside-down kingdom, where the poor in spirit and the persecuted are blessed, where the meek inherit the earth, where peacemakers are the ones who are going to see God, not those who come with a sword to conquer. Right? Those who are persecuted for righteousness, theirs is the kingdom of heaven. You're going to hear the word kingdom over and over and over again in Matthew. Where we're told to lay up treasure in heaven, not on earth, very opposite to what we learn in our culture in any part of the world. And instead of being built through coercion and force, his kingdom was going to be built through just this message that he was going to spread, which was actually going to be expanded through his people, who weren't warriors. Yeah, although there is a place for warrior that comes later. So his words are like these seeds that go out, and they sprout the kingdom through people. And it's his people that transform the earth to be more like him. So even though we're in this in-between stage of this kingdom that's come, it's the now, but the not quite yet, we are actually sprouting his kingdom wherever we go. So Jesus came to give the earth a little foretaste of heaven. A taste of what life will be like. This is what we're looking forward to. When he forgave the sinful. When he exorcised demons. When he healed the sick. When he brought peace. When he brought restoration, unity amongst people. And he moved in compassion and authority. He didn't move with force or dictatorship, coercion at all. So the Jewish nation was like the people at that time were hoping he would conquer Rome, but instead he actually came and conquered a bigger enemy that they didn't even know they really had at the time, right? He brought the kingdom to earth and he demolished the kingdom of Satan. They also expected him to build up a temple. And instead, he goes, that temple's going to be destroyed.
That's right.
Because I know you're going to reject the king. And this will be the consequence of that.
Yeah.
And then, shortly after he announces that he is the king, and here's the kingdom, he allows his body, be destroyed and planted in the earth. And like Raiden said, his body, he became sin.
That's right.
And then he rose from the dead. And as he did, the physical earth trembled. And bodies rose from graves all over the place because the earth knew the king had arrived. The earth knew, even if the people didn't recognize it. And the temple, that big curtain in the temple, was torn from top to bottom. And then Christ rose, and he was vindicated by God and given authority to rule.
Amen.
That's the God we serve. That's the God we serve. So we may be in the in-between, but oh, we serve a powerful God. Being in the in-between does not diminish his power. So the place is this present, but there's also a future place for us, isn't there? Right?
Yeah.
There's going to be a new heavens and a new earth. It's going to be tangible. It's going to be material. Christ, the fact that Christ came in bodily form shows that he came to show that there is going to be a spiritual but also physical renewal of everything.
Yeah.
The fact that he rose from the grave and he was seen by hundreds of people in a physical form before he ascended. The fact that when he ascended, he was seen by people. All speaks to the fact that this is going to be a physical renewal for his people, for his place. It's a pretty, really exciting, super exciting.
Amen.
Yay, amen, right? Yeah. Okay, so that's Matthew. Okay, then we go into Mark. So Matthew was all about God's place and the renewal of earth, and bringing kingdom principles to earth. So Mark, I love Mark. Mark's like this really short little book. It's like he had to get things out real fast. He was so excited to write this stuff down. It's all about the king's power. All about the king's power.
Yeah.
It's the shortest gospel, so this is maybe a good one to start with in the summer. Go to Mark. Get to know your king. He's succinct, he's to the point, and this is his point. Jesus is the all-powerful king above all things. He rules as king. He's the anointed Messiah. He's acting on behalf of, but in union with, God's will. Some people thought it was okay to accept him as maybe a messenger of God. He's doing things on behalf of God. But it was harder to accept that he was God. So in the upside-down kingdom, it becomes clear that the power of the king is manifested not in the big things we usually associate with power, but in suffering. That's where you see the best of his power, is in suffering. So we think about the crucifixion. And Mark talks about how Jesus, as king, is in absolute full control of his death. He's anointed for death by a woman at Bethany. He points out the disciple that's going to betray him, so he predicts it. He foretells Peter's denial of him after his death. He acknowledges the Father's will, and he allows himself to be arrested. And he remains silent all through the trials, because he doesn't need to defend himself because he knows what his ultimate goal is. He accepts his death in front of hundreds of mockers, many thousands. And then a Roman centurion declares him to be the Son of God. And throughout the whole narrative of Mark, we see that the king has ultimate power over everything. Earthly, heavenly, everything. So he is power. He is the king. He has power over demons, disease, death, nature.
Yes.
He has the authority to forgive sin. And he refers to himself as the Son of Man. And that's actually a reference back to Daniel. I'm actually going to read this scripture to you because this is the God we serve. So Daniel, back in the Old Testament, this is the God that the Jewish people, so they would have known the scripture. So whenever Jesus brought up the word Son of Man, the Jews would have been thinking about scripture, either this one or something along these lines.
Yeah.
In my vision at night, I looked, and there before me was one like a Son of Man, coming with the clouds of heaven. He approached the Ancient of Days and was led into his presence. He was given authority, glory, and sovereign power. All nations and peoples of every language worshiped him. His dominion is an everlasting dominion that will not pass away, and his kingdom is one that will never be destroyed.
Come on.
Isn't that amazing?
Yeah.
Did you notice the past tense? He's been given And that he is, and his kingdom is, and it will never. So that whole idea of power in Mark, again, it's not linked to coercion. It's linked to protection, creation, and flourishing of people. He wanted that woman at the, that particular woman at the well, to flourish.
Yeah.
And that's his desire for every single one of us. Right?
Yeah.
All right, so we've got place, we've got power, right? So we're going to go on to Luke. Guess what Luke is all about? Anybody read Luke? People.
No.
Here comes the people part. Matthew, you'll see. When you study it for your own, you'll see. Matthew's all about place. Mark's about king's power. And the Gospel of Luke is all about the people. Here's that upside down kingdom principle again. Who are the people of the kingdom? Educated?
No.
The politically powerful?
No.
The fully equipped?
I stand here as not fully equipped, so I certainly hope that's not true.
The righteous? The religious. So Jesus' kingdom is actually always made up of the poor, the weak, the neglected. The people who come by a youth service and hear a majestic song.
That's right.
And are drawn in because they feel their need.
That's right.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
That's who's part of the kingdom.
That's right.
So in this book, Patrick Schreiner says, God did not die for the good and the beautiful.
Yeah.
We should write that on our walls. That should be a big saying on my wall for sure. He came for the sick, the unloved, the unloved, and the unlovable. So Luke does a lot of this contrasting of people. He contrasts the rich with the supposedly and the supposedly faithful with people who actually will inherit the kingdom. The marginal, the rejected, the poor, the tax collectors, the sinners, women, Samaritans, Gentiles, lost sheep, prodigal son. These are all stories that he tells. And this is all part of Luke's narrative. The faithful, the persistent widow, the Pharisee, the tax collector. Children can just get into the kingdom, right? Now, I want you to contrast that. So the story of the Samaritan woman is in John chapter 4. But if you go back to John chapter 3, Jesus has a conversation with Nicodemus. Okay, so we're going to contrast a little bit. We're going to do a little bit of Lukeism here on John's narrative. So I want you to think about how Jesus talked to the Samaritan woman compared to how he talked to Nicodemus. Okay? There's a few things that just stuck out to me. The woman at the well wasn't looking for Jesus. She was just going about her business. Had to get water when it was convenient for her and nobody else was around. He actually sought her out. Right? He went because he knew she was going to be there. He entered her space and he initiated the conversation. She wouldn't have spoken to him. Right? He initiated the conversation. And he was conversational with her. He allowed her to ask questions. He talked to her. He treated her like he would anybody. Right? He didn't look down on her, and he was really loving and kind in his responses to her. And he really drew out with questions. And the questions he asked slowly just revealed her need of a savior. She thought she needed water, but actually she needed more, much more than that. And in the way he spoke to her, he honored her, and he demonstrated that she had value and worth. And then he reveals himself directly to her. Like, no beating around the bush, I am he. Right? And so she gets this personal revelation from the king. Her response is immediate. She runs out, talks to people. All right. So she's got this unstoppable desire to bring others to see this guy. You've got to see this guy. This is it. This is the Messiah. Okay, so now we'll go back to Nicodemus. This is now in chapter 3. So this guy is now, he's highly educated, he's highly revered teacher amongst his people. He is a member of the Jewish ruling council. I don't think that Nicodemus was a bad man. I think he was actually a really good man. He had a really good heart. But Jesus allowed Nicodemus to seek him out. Right? He came looking for Jesus at night. He did it at night when no one else would know. Okay, maybe that's a bit similar to this lady getting her water when no one else is around. The Nicodemus had seen something in Jesus and he suspected that he was actually sent from God. So he comes to investigate him, right? Nicodemus has come with an agenda. And and he seeks him out. He's looking for some answers. So this is what Nicodemus says in John 3. If you want to read the whole story, it's in John 3, about verse 1 to 15. So Nicodemus starts by saying this, "Rabbi, we know that you are a teacher who has come from God, for no one could perform the signs you are doing if God were not with him." And Jesus replied, "Very truly, I tell you, no one can see the kingdom of God unless they are born again." Did he ask a question? Interesting. "How can someone be born when they're old?" Nicodemus asked. "Surely they cannot enter a second time into their mother's womb to be born." And Jesus answered, "Very truly, I tell you, no one can enter the kingdom of God unless they're born of water and the Spirit." So it kind of seems like Jesus is changing the subject a little bit there, doesn't it? But actually, he's actually really, he's directly addressing Nicodemus's misconception of him. So Nicodemus, he's like, you think I'm being used by God? I am God. I am the kingdom. So Nicodemus is confused, and then Jesus goes on to explain. But just look at how he talks to this worthy, educated leader. "How can this be?" Nicodemus asked. "You are Israel's teacher," said Jesus, "and you do not understand these things? Very truly, I tell you, we speak of what we know, and we testify to what we have seen. But still, you people do not accept our testimony. I have spoken to you of earthly things, and you do not believe. How then will you believe if I speak of heavenly things? No one has ever gone into heaven except the one that came from heaven, the Son of Man. Just as Moses lifted up the snake in the wilderness, so the Son of Man must be lifted up, that everyone who believes may have eternal life in him." Totally different kind of conversation here. In fact, Nicodemus doesn't say anything else after this. Jesus just talks to him. He asks those direct questions, and he's almost accusing, "You people, who's he talking about? You religious people, right? You think you've got it all together? You think you got enough knowledge? You think you know who God is? You don't understand anything. You are just like everyone else who needs a Savior. And you're going to have to start from scratch just like everybody else.
Yeah.
Nothing you have done or can ever do will ever get you into the kingdom. Only I can do that for you. Only I can."
Amen.
Now for those of us who have already accepted the King, that is completely free. Right? It's his righteousness that draws us into the kingdom and keeps us in the kingdom as well. You have to be born again. And then he quotes that ancient scripture and says, "Son of Man," and right away Nicodemus knows exactly what Jesus is saying. He knows he's claiming to be God. And does Nicodemus believe right away? He goes away and he's pondering the words, and later on you hear Nicodemus again. He actually is one of the guys who helps to arrange for the burial for Jesus. So we know that a change has happened, but it's not the same as what happened to that Samaritan woman. Isn't that interesting? There's a verse in the Bible, I'm sorry I didn't look it up, but you know the verse that says it's harder for a rich man to enter the kingdom? It's not because rich people or wealthy people or well put together people are more or less worthy of the kingdom. That's not what it is at all. It's just that it's really hard for them to see their need.
Yes, that's right.
When you're in a place of need, you see your need for the kingdom so much quicker.
Yeah.
And that's why Jesus came to those who were weak and powerless. He came to give them power. Give them back. So, of course, there's lots of Luke about taking up your cross and following Jesus. There's lots of upside downness there. Once again, in Luke, we see that he is completely in charge of his death and resurrection. Everything's according to plan. It looks like things are falling apart, but the king is being killed, and nope, it's all according to plan. So even on the way to the cross, he says to some women, "Don't cry for me. Weep for yourselves. There's some work ahead. The kingdom has come, but it's not fully realized. And the kingdom is going to be taken by force, and you're going to have to suffer. After his resurrection, and this is in Luke 24:45, it says, "Then he opened their minds so they could understand the scriptures." I love it. Every time it says in the word, "Then he opened their minds," personal revelation for these people.
Yeah, you're right.
How amazing is that? "He told them, this is what is written. The Messiah will suffer and rise from the dead on the third day. And repentance for the forgiveness of sins will be preached in his name to all nations, beginning at Jerusalem. And then he tells his followers to wait for the Holy Spirit, because he's going to equip them with power from on high. So the all-powerful king is going to equip his people, the weak and the needy and the heartbroken and the broken and the ill-equipped and the, all of those, with power from the all-powerful king. And then, with that power, they can face this stage between when he arrived and inaugurated the kingdom and when he's going to come and fulfill it. It's his power that allows us to live triumphant lives now. Right now, today, regardless of our circumstances. Okay, so Matthew, you guys remember? Place, yes?
Yeah.
Mark?
Power.
And then people in Luke, right? If you connect it back to the Old Testament, Abraham actually left three things when he left his homeland. He left a place. He left his people. God promised him a new people, right?
Yeah.
And then he also left any power that he had. All three of these promises were fulfilled in Christ. Yeah. All of them. Jesus restored the land. He formed a new people. And he was himself, that new ruler, power. So the kingdom has come and is yet to come. So here's where it becomes difficult, because now we are in that in-between place. We know the king. We are promised a place in which we can live in communion with our king, both now and in the future. Right? We live in community with like-minded people who believe and honor the king. But it doesn't just stop there, it goes deeper than that. We don't just honor the king, he raises us up to places of honor. We don't just serve the king, he becomes closer than a brother, our papa, our father.
Yeah.
He invites us into such deep, deep intimacy. So in this time in between, when we're not just waiting for the completeness of the kingdom to actually be fulfilled, we are actively ushering in the kingdom, right? Right now, during our time on earth. And we're not alone. And I'm saying that on two levels. We're not alone because of our relationship with him and the power of the Holy Spirit in us. We are also not alone because we're together as a people.
Yes.
And it's just becoming more and more apparent that God moves through people, plural, not just person. We need to have that unity together, to move together, and to be there to help each other when we are in places of desperation, to lift each other up, to encourage, to worship together, to remind ourselves who our King is and where our power comes from. Okay, so now the fourth gospel. Remember, there's one more gospel, but we've already covered the first three things, so now what is John all about? Okay, so John is the only gospel where he actually writes exactly what the gospel is about. Alright, so in John 20, verse 31, he says, I write these things that you may believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that by believing you may have life in his name.
Yeah.
So John's gospel is all about, okay, we know the place, we have a current place, a future place, a hope of a future kingdom. We have a king, we have a people to do this whole kingdom thing with. And John says, aha, now I'm going to show you something even neater. Really cool. So, Jesus is not just the giver of life. He is life. Right? And Jesus, the Word made flesh, is life for us. He's the light of the world who gives light. Now, these are all things that John talks about. If you want the scripture references, you just text me later. I'll send you all the nice verses. He's the resurrection and the life. His commandments are eternal life. God is the living God, so life belongs to God, but it also characterizes God. Isn't that interesting? Life comes from God, and the mediator of life is Christ. And then we see this shift to John where life becomes another metaphor for kingdom. He starts to use the word in, like kind of interrelated with each other and interchangeably. I have come that you might have life, and life more abundantly. He's talking about kingdom, living in the kingdom. So So Jesus gives life and material things. He's a provider, of course, but he is life. And then, wait, there's more. His resurrection gives us eternal life, right? Not just life now in this kingdom, but eternal life in the kingdom to come. So our life as Christians, once you're a believer, your life is a reality lived fully in the present, but always looking towards the future, always. And that's where our hope comes from, because we hope in the living hope, Jesus Christ himself. So over and over and over again through all four Gospels, we just keep bumping up against this whole thing of this upside-down kingdom. The kingdom will not come by coercion and dominance, but through sacrifice and suffering. So the gift of eternal life in the future gives us confidence to view our present reality, whatever your reality is, in light of the divine realities that are actually happening simultaneously as God brings his kingdom to earth. So when we pray those words, our Father in heaven, give us this day, bring your kingdom come on earth as it is in heaven. We're asking him to right the things that are wrong and to create a place of transformation here in each one of us, but also in the earth. So the Samaritan woman, we have to go back to her. She was changed, her heart was changed, but her circumstances did not change. Do you agree? But from the moment she met Christ and believed in him, she started living in the tension of the kingdom is here, but not quite yet. So even though he used her to spread the kingdom, she still had to go deal with those broken relationships. She still had to make a decision. Her heart was being transformed. The Bible doesn't tell us, but I'm sure that there's a whole story of her life that could be written about how she made things right with people. What decision did she make about this man she was living with? Because that wouldn't have sat well with her spirit, right? What about the people she spoke to, the lives that she changed? There could be whole books written about their lives, right? So she knew the king. He'd given her a sense of value. So even though we don't have a book about it, we know what happened to her. Because it's happening to us, right? We can use our imaginations. So we know the King, we know the Messiah, we're in the process of being transformed, but continually. It's not an instantaneous thing. It's like this thing that happens in stages. And our God is so gracious that when we mess up, he forgives us. And he says, come back. Let me show you how to make it right. Let me show you life. Let me show you life more abundantly than what you are choosing to do.
Amen.
He allowed himself to become seed. I'm going to repeat something Raven said. He allowed himself to become seed that he would die for us, be planted in the ground, and rise up victorious over death.
Yeah.
The king himself took the punishment for every lifetime of sin, past, present, and future. And then he clothes us in his righteousness. So, Jenna, your testimony this morning was so appropriate. I was actually grinning at Derek because I was like, yes, that's how God sees us.
Yes.
Clothed, pure, untouched, unsullied.
Yeah, believe it.
Doesn't mean we don't mess up again, but that's how he sees us, because we're his people. Yeah, we're his people. And so now, we become seed, holy seed. And I think right now she said this, or it might have been Ken, but he said that the Holy Spirit is like the wind that blows that seed, right? You allow the Holy Spirit to move you into places that you never knew you were going to step out to, in faith and boldness. And we bring the kingdom wherever we go. So we have access to him through prayer. We have his living word at our fingertips. We've hidden his word in our heart. And yet we still live in that in-between place where there is suffering. And we do go through stuff. And we as a church body, in this last couple years, we've gone through stuff, right? Personally and corporately. We still face hardship. We face the consequences of our poor decisions. We also face the consequences of other people's poor decisions, which is sometimes even harder. So we as yet. But, and here's where I hope we get some encouragement today. In this in-between stage, we also have life. I'm talking life capital L. The giver of life himself flowing through our veins. Physically, spiritually, emotionally, he is our life. And he is working all things for our good and his glory. So none of this, I'm going to say it again, this is not new news, right? But this is very good news. It's good news. There are so many times in the Bible where, particularly David, would go back and preach to himself. Why, my soul, are you so downcast? Trust in God, my hope in God, my hope in God. I will still trust you, my rock, my redeemer. We need to preach to ourselves sometimes,
yes.
Right?
Yeah.
We need to remind ourselves because life is hard, but we have living hope.
Amen.
And Christ suffered. We're his people. Do we think that we're better than him? That we're not going to suffer and go through stuff? But in that place when we're suffering, we reach out to him. Take it to him and say, God, I don't understand. Cry out to him. Ask him questions. But don't turn your back. Look to the King. Look to the King.
Yeah.
And he will rise up when you expect him to do great things. Because he was unexpected. Don't expect him to do what you want him to do. You're going to fall into that old trap of poorly placed expectations. But when you open yourself up to his sovereignty, his glory, his power, and expect him to do great things, he will surprise you. And it won't be with coercion, of course. It's going to be with tenderness and compassion and love and a power beyond anything you've ever experienced. So, are you letting him be king? So what's king in your life? And I'm preaching to myself now. What is guiding your decisions? What's haunting you at night? A lot of times it's fear, right? Fear of the future. Fear of man. Fear of the unknown. Fear of not having enough. Fear of not being enough for your family. But we just need to remind ourselves, there is, just because we're in the in-between and God's kingdom hasn't been fully consummated yet, where he's made everything perfect, it does not diminish God's goodness. It does not diminish God's power. And it does not limit our access to every spiritual gift that he has given us in Christ. So I want you to go out today and I want you to live with hope. Live with hope. I also want you to study the gospel. But live with hope first. And I want you to live from a place of trusting him. That he knows better than we know. Even when things are really, 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 really hard, he knows better. And he is working all things for good. So I think it's time we let God be king.
That's right.
All right, so let's pray. God, I just want to thank you. I want to say again how overwhelmed I am by your goodness. And how very, very little I understand of who you really are. Oh, but God, I want to know you more. God, I want to invite you into our church family. Start with each one of us as individuals, God. Come and be king. Display your glory and power. Convince us in stages that you are who you say you are. Convince us that you have the power to do what you say you're going to do. Free us to expect mighty, powerful things from you. Surprise us with your goodness and your grace and your mercy. And when we don't see it, remind us over and over again of who you are and why we're here.
Yep.
What our purpose and destiny is, and that you are our living hope. Teach us to preach to ourselves, God, on the basis of your word and in the power of your mighty name, we pray this. So I'm going to invite you. It's not just me that's ministering today. We've had Cassie minister. We've had people give testimonies. My dad made a comment to me last night. He said, when people do testimonies at your church, they don't just testify. They write a word. And that's true, right? So I'm going to invite you. If you are in a place where you need to be encouraged, use your people. Ask someone to come and pray with you today. Share your heart. Maybe you just need to unload something. Hey, and have someone encourage you. If you're not preaching to yourself, ask someone, hey, this is where I'm in. I don't get what's going on. Please come and talk to me. Build me up because I need to be welcome today. All right? So So Cassie, would you mind coming and doing, is she here? Oh, there you go, sorry. So Cassie, like, if you wouldn't mind coming and doing a little bit of beautiful worship. Yes. And then if you have a need, you're more than welcome to come and pray with one of the elders or Jess. But you actually just choose someone you trust, right? Go to the people, use your people, because God is using them to lift you up. Awesome. So we'll have a time of prayer, and then you are free to have some coffee and just love each other today.